Hey everyone and welcome back to my channel. Today, we're going to be discussing the latest episode of The Mandalorian Season 3, Episode 3. This episode takes us on a journey through the New Republic's amnesty program and the morality of cloning. But let's not forget about our beloved characters Din Djarin, Bo-Katan, and Baby Yoda. So, let's dive in and see if this episode is worth your time. Some could contend Din Djarin is acting a little unappreciative. He often talks about taking a bath in the living waters in the mines of Mandalore. But once he's in it, all of a sudden it becomes an issue because he's drowning, right? Poor on his part. Even so, Episode 3 basically resumed off where Episode 2 left off, with Bo-Katan saving Din's life. He took a sample of the water to establish it was really the living waters of Mandalore. And as a result, was redeemed, thus he appears to be doing rather well with his near-death experience. Bo might have mentioned the enormous mythosaur she saw underwater while saving Din at this point, but she chose not to. Were we able to trust her? Bo, Din, and Baby Yoda are shot up by TIE interceptors, who also demolish Bo's residence. Before we have a chance to reflect on this, Bo-Katan may not be the most sincere of the Mandalorian characters, but it seems like she never has a good day, don't you think? Nevertheless, the TIE interceptors are destroyed and the group accelerates into space after an exciting but very conventional action scenario. The remainder of the episode is then set on Coruscant, where we first encounter Dr. Pershing. He is testifying for the New Republic, which is offering to free him provided he works for them as part of their amnesty program, despite the fact that it has been shown that his history is, to put it mildly, dubious. Dr. Pershing says he's pleased to employ advanced cloning procedures to serve the New Republic, which sounds entirely ethical and not at all suspicious, adding to the melting pot of salvation. The most renowned participant in the amnesty program is G-68, who, as Azalea Kane, had worked for none other than Star Wars villain Moff Gideon. G-68 appears more eager to leave her Imperial past behind than Pershing does, who acknowledges that he misses being an Imperial scientist while being in cahoots with the Mandalorian's Big Bad. Remember, this is in no way a warning or omen of bad things to come. Following an uncomfortable first day in which G-68 plays a practical joke on Dr. Pershing, the latter is then interrogated. Pershing is still working on the cloning issue and requests permission to continue his study, but the New Republic's legal system forbids this. Even still, the scientist doesn't seem willing to give up, and he ultimately persuades G-68 to allow him to show that his work on cloning would benefit the New Republic. She decides to aid him, even if it means violating the rules of their recently discovered amnesty, and he succeeds. G-68 follows Pershing to the waste yards to seek for the old Imperial equipment when he complains that he can't use it anymore. Pershing appears to have found the necessary supplies when they are able to board an abandoned Star Destroyer. But G-68 later exposes her true motivations. It comes out that she had been planning to frame Pershing the entire time and had been betraying him. This is when New Republic soldiers arrive, capture Pershing in the act, and drag him off. Pershing is put in a behavior modification, mind flare device intended to make him act more subservient to the New Republic in a hilarious homage to the anime series Star Wars Rebels. A soldier commends Aaliyah for her job, but as soon as he departs, she intensifies the mind control technology to a dangerous degree. There are so many warning signs now that I've lost track. When the episode concludes, we finally catch up with Din and Bo-Katan after what seems like an eternity. They arrive to a hidden Mandalore location where they come upon Paz Vizsla and the rest of the Watch. Din claims that after taking a bath in the living waters of Mandalore, he is no longer an apostate. The armorer confirms this after receiving a little tube of the water, and she also affirms that Bo-Katan is also redeemed along with Din. Guys, follow this path. And with that, Episode 3 ends. The truth is that I adore politics. It's eye-opening to learn more about the New Republic's, an unusual philosophy because it truly helps to understand the moral ambiguity that even the so-called good people experience. It fits in nicely with the animated series The Clone Wars or Star Wars Rebels, which likewise extensively examined the dubious philosophies of the Old and New Republic. Yet there is a very big caveat to everything. I didn't turn on the TV to see a show about the New Republic, Dr. Pershing, and the morality of cloning. I watched The Mandalorian while it was on. However, The Mandalorian Season 3 seems to be another Star Wars project that has trouble maintaining focus, much like the Book of Boba Fett did. This is not to argue that any of this background information is unimportant or that Episode 3 was uninteresting. But given Episode 2's high standard, I felt as though I had to slog through 40 minutes of expository muck just to catch a peek of the main character. Even so, Baby Yoda made a cute gurgling sound that appeared to be him saying, "This is the way, so I'm prepared to give this episode a second chance." But if The Last of Us Episode 9 and Episode 3 have taught me anything, it's that I should never, ever trust a doctor. Overall, this episode may not have focused entirely on our main characters, but it did provide some interesting insight into the New Republic's philosophy and the morality of cloning. While some may have found it a bit slow-paced, the appearance of our favorite characters at the end made it worth the watch. So, what did you think of this episode? Let me know in the comments below. Thanks for tuning into my review of The Mandalorian Season 3, Episode 3. Don't forget to like and subscribe for more content like this, and I'll see you in the next one.